Jamal Bruce Washington was born April 21, 1971 in Oakland, California. He attended Pixley Elementary and Tulare Union High School in Pixley, California. He completed two semesters at College of the Sequoias in Visalia, California. He received certificates as a welder and took classes in electrical appliances. In 2012, he moved to Los Angeles. I think we said we changed it to 2011, I think, or something, yeah. He moved to Los Angeles to help care for his uncle Lawrence Verner after Lawrence suffered a stroke. While in Los Angeles and working for Plan Check Restaurant, he decided to attend Trade Tech College and enroll in the Culinary Arts Program until he became too ill to attend. Jamal joined Robbins Memorial Church of God in Christ under the leadership of Elder Emmanuel Collins. Ushering was a position that Jamal loved as a member of his church. He was a member of the men's department and participated in men's day programs each year while a member of Robbins. Jamal was a worker and enjoyed helping anyone who requested his help. Whenever I called my son, this is Don Zella speaking, and asked how he was doing, he always says, "I am
blessed."
And that was his word, "I'm blessed and highly favored." On Saturday, July 29, 2017, at 8:26 p.m. in the evening, Jamal struggled and pain of life ended. He was preceded in death by his father, Jess Bruce Washington, and Aunt Florida Verner. He leaves to mourn his passing, his mother, Donzella Washington, who loved him dearly, his sister, Kimberly, brother, Jess Ezell, Aunt Nancy Wright, cousins, and friends. And as we say, we love Jamal, but God loves him.
And her memory is
is better than mine. So there are instances when I was in Jamal's presence, but I really don't remember what took place. I just remember that I was in his presence. But when I went out to the hospital to see Jamal, and we had time to conversate with each other, I got a deeper understanding of who Jamal was. And I'll bring that up just briefly. But I do want to read a scripture that I think would be apropos. It's my favorite scripture, one that I depend on, and that is Romans 8:28, the man that spoke about Jamal. He quoted from that scripture. It's familiar. All things work together for good to them that love the Lord God, to call according to his purpose.
Yes.
Death can be awfully cruel. It catches us off guard every time. The doctors can say we got 6 months to a year, but that's too large a window. They can call everyone to the hospital and say your loved one's not going to live through the night. Everyone that wants to come up and say anything to them, you need to get up here right away. 3 days later, they're feeling better. 3 months later, they're at home. And we're wondering what happened. So death never, it gives us a warning sometimes, but it never pinpoints when it's coming. It's what always catches us off guard. What the young man said, I know that in his heart, that's not what he meant when he said, I'm happy that he passed. But let's look at it this way. He may have said what we generally and compassionately hope for.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Because pain and suffering,
that's right.
Lying on a bed, being the person that you were never meant to be, the person that others know who you are, the struggle that it takes to tell someone, I'm okay, when the morphine isn't working, to have good spirits and high spirits, when you're laying on a bed and you can't even do for yourself. Compassionately, we say, Lord, whatever your will is.
Yes.
That's a prayer.
Yes.
That says, I'm okay with whatever you decide, Lord.
Yes.
I don't want to see my loved one like this.
Yes.
And so it was difficult when I walked into the room to see him in the condition that he was in. But once we started talking, my stress level went down, and I was put at ease by him. And all of the things that have been said about him this morning, in a very short period of time, less than an hour, I experienced all that.
Lord have mercy.
One of the main things that stood out to me, a couple of things did stick out, but he's laying here, and of course, when you go to the hospital, one of the questions you have to ask that individual is, do you need anything? Yeah. So this guy asked me. I said, do you need anything? Yeah, there's an ATM machine down on the first floor. Can you take my car and get me some money? I said, sure. So he said, do you need any money? I said, no, I'm good. I'm good, thanks a lot. Now, when you give somebody your PIN number, send them to the bank, you expose your account.
Yes, right.
But I knew how much money he had after he got that money, and he was asking me if I needed any money. So our bankroll was about the same, $63. But he was willing to give me a number, and I don't know if I was just asking to be nice. But that's something that I found out about him. And so here are the words that I wrote down. That he's a helper.
Yes.
He's a helper. Somebody said that he was sweet. And sweet and kind are pretty much the same thing. And you know that if he's sweet, it was a woman that said it. So, he was sweet. He was kind. Brother James said, I hope so. He was a servant. He was a servant. Goes along with his gift of help. But we ought to be servants of one another. So I would assume that as we have sat here this morning and we've heard that Jamal was a servant, he was also a teacher. And I hope that he has taught us this morning that we heard that you got to be a servant, that we go out of here as servants. Just in honor of Jamal. So sometimes when we say no, maybe we should say yes. Because one thing about him that everybody said was he didn't say no to you if you needed some help.
Right.
So what is it in his personality that's not in ours that we can't always say, okay, I'm going to help you? So it means that he wasn't a judgmental person. He was kind and he was sweet. He was a fighter.
Yes.
He wasn't giving up.
Right.
No way was he giving up. His words were, I'm doing fine, and he trusted in God.
Yes.
Concerned about his mother. I just want to make sure, I just got off the phone with my mother. I want to make sure that she's okay. And he was fighting to make sure that you were okay, to hang on as long as he could. But I think it made a difference to him when he was able to go home and not be in the hospital. But I was disappointed. I'll tell you about that later. I was disappointed that he was released at the time that he was released. He was respected. Very, very respected. Nobody in here said that he was disrespectful. That's one thing I noticed about doing services like this. That when you are in a service like this and you hear people talking and you know the individual that they're talking about and everything sounds just so good, and you say, well, who are they talking about? That's not the person that I know. But do you realize that everybody in here knew the same person?
Yes.
He was no different with anyone. You knew him. And I think that that's just one of the virtues. No need to get up and tell a lie about somebody. God is the judge.
Yes.
He judges us righteously. No matter what my mama say, that don't mean I'm getting into heaven. Remember that. He was a learner. Sister said he was learning as he was doing it. If he didn't know how to do it, he would learn how to do it. And that's to be helpful, to be generous and kind. That's the type of person he is. Someone used the word earnest. I put genuine, but that's the same thing. He was earnest. course we know that because everybody had the same experience with him. He's very busy, like to stay busy and being helpful. We'll keep you busy. Sister said he was attentive to the smallest details. If something was out of place on you, he would bring it to your attention. That's a real expression of love, because sometimes what's out of place, you really need to have it corrected. But people are ashamed to say, hey, you got something going on here that we pay attention to. I was at Kaiser yesterday, and the little lady was on her walker. She was walking, and I was walking past her, and she looked up and smiled, and she said, "Your shirt's not very right." Because she cared about how I looked. So obviously that's how Jamal was. He cared enough to think about the person whose presence he was. And he was compassionate. He could feel what others were going through.
Well.
And he not only felt it, but he responded to it. He took action to do something about it. And so when we talked, he came down, he said, "I came down to take care of Uncle Lawrence. And now I'm in this position." I said, "Well, now it's time for somebody to take care of you, Jamal. You have to learn to accept that." And I close with this. I told him about a seminar that I went to that I'll never forget. It's called the Stretcher Bearer Seminar. And all of us are potential stretcher bearers. In other words, people are going to need us. But at one time, we're all on the stretcher. We're going to need some attention.
Yeah.
And so he was aware that he was a helper. And like us all, we want to be independent. We want to take care of ourselves. But sometimes when you need the help, accept it. It's okay to accept help.
Amen.
And he came to grips with that. He said, I know that I got to get some help. Last thing, he was a clean individual. That he had gotten dropped off, and he didn't have his clothing and things, but one thing he did call me and asked, "Bring my shower chair." He was clean. He wanted to take care of his hygiene. And that's very important. You know, a sick person and trying to maintain their hygiene. So Dantel, I just, and family, I want to say that God has never made a mistake. It's so important to be a part of a God-fearing family.
Yes.
Where God is the center of the focus in our lives. We might fumble and get astray, but we know who God is, and that comes out.
Yes.
And we're all problems, we've been problems, but when we come to ourselves, we come back to our foundation. And we don't judge people for their past, we judge people for their acceptance of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior in their life.
Amen.
Paul said, "I count all of that as waste, but I press toward the mark of a high calling in Jesus Christ," and that's what Paul was doing. So, on behalf of our family, thank you very much for your attendance here. Thank you for giving us your impression.
Amen.
Your understanding of who Jamal was. Because he meant a great deal to us. And we thank you.